30 minutes for comments and questions, and I will try really hard to, there's one right there.
There's a case similar to what you were just talking about.
Can we have somebody cut the mic down?
But there's a short cable.
We got a cable, okay.
There's a couple of cases that are similar to what you were talking about, and I just wonder if anybody's accounting for it. The Spanish mined a lot of silver out of a particular mine in Bolivia back in the 1600s or something like that, and silver just flooded the Spanish market and became worthless, basically, for years, because of all that stuff hitting the market. And then we also have the case of the America is being claimed by everybody. If you look at what they gave Columbus, they basically gave him carte blanche, which sounded very much like what you just said. And I just wonder if anybody's taking into account those two historical things that we have from the Spanish colonization of the Americas. It sounds very much like what the American colonization of space is going on. So I just wondered if you had a chance to look at that.
I can talk loud, but I don't know if the...
Let's take three or four questions.
Oh, really? Okay.
Three or four questions at one time? Okay. Anybody else?
Okay, so it looks like we're going to take three or four questions at a time and then respond. So is there somebody else who would like to ask a question or make a comment?
Oh, thanks. I just had a question for Dr. Ghosh-Roy. At the end of his presentation, he explained that his report proved the allegations that were made by Schwartz to be true, that the missile test was total failure, but that this 42-page letter, consequently, I didn't catch what the result was. I thought he would bring an end to this whole system with his report, and he says it was undone by some 42-page letter. I just wanted to get clear on that.
Is there another question or comment?
Yes, I have that comment.
The highly technical and valuable presentation which have been made is not just for listening and forgetting and going away. These materials have to be used to spread awareness in our communities so that the danger of weaponization waste can be spread over and make the people understand. Therefore, what I suggest is put all these presentations in pen drives and supply that pen drive to us so that we can make use of it. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great idea. Is there one more?
Over the years, I've taken some. Whoops. I can talk loud.
No, you can't. They won't hear you.
Well, we've come here.
Over the years, I've taken some comfort in the fact that so many of these tests fail. Is that
justified? Okay, so I think what we're going to do is respond to these first.
We'll come back.
We'll come back to you. Okay.
Sabrata, did you get that? There were two questions for you. Did you hear them?
Yeah. Actually, unfortunately, I could not understand the questions. I didn't want to interrupt them, but the first question was about the letter and something about the whistleblowing by Neera Schwartz. But if you could just ask the question one more time, I could answer.
John.
Can you come to the microphone?
Could you just explain how your analysis was disregarded by the Congress?
Okay. Thank you. The analysis that I made after 2 years of review, basically, it was a purely scientific analysis, and I had some consultants. So within the GAO, when we presented the results of my analysis, it created a real problem for them, because normally GAO doesn't go into mostly this technical analysis, so they can just come up with some wishy-washy language saying, well, it was mostly technical, some scientists say this, other scientists say that, so we really don't know because we can't evaluate. But in this particular instance, there were technical people like myself with GAO who could stand up this analysis, and I actually challenge anybody from the Pentagon to come and take this analysis and find faults with it. Of course, there was nobody who wanted to do that. And so instead, GAO refused to publish the specific language that I wrote about the failure of the test, and published a report that's, again, very, very wishy-washy. And that was the main reason why I had gone public about it. But the Congress absolutely ignored it.
The second question for you is, are these failures of missile defense testing, is it a good thing that they're failing?
There are, as I tried to point out, the missile defense system is not covered by the normal regulations. They are exempt, so there are no standards. So if you hear people like Phil Coyle, who used to be the director of operational testing, he will tell you there is no way to test the systems because there are no specific requirements and no benchmarks. So whatever you get is what you get, and you feel it like that, just like what Rumsfeld had said, something is better than nothing.
And I think that the missile defense is a Trojan horse. So whether they don't care whether it works or not. I mean, I think they'd like it to work, but those launch systems are offensive. So you can skirt. I mean, I think one of the reasons, and Bruce could talk about this more, but I think one of the reasons they call it missile defense is because they can skirt whatever agreements they already have. And they're like, we're not putting an offensive system in Poland. We're putting an offensive system in Poland. So, you know, now they're putting them on ships, so they're placing them everywhere. What's the difference between a missile defense and a missile offense system? It's still a ballistic missile.
Yeah, that's a very important point. In fact, this is one of the points that Russia makes about the new Aegis Ashore facility in Romania. I heard, or I saw a video of Vladimir Putin saying, you know what? They could take these so-called missile defense systems, the missiles, out of this Aegis Ashore launch facility in Romania and replace it with cruise missiles, because the cruise missiles can be fired from that complex in Romania and next year in one in Poland. And so now you replace missile defense with an offensive cruise missile, which is a first strike attack weapon. And they're right on basically Russian borders. And so that's Russia's problem with it.
But it's never failed because the first objective of it is to spend money.
It's a success because it spends money. I want to add the military-industrial space complex is the code word, the hashtag they use if you tweet or whatever is space security. And I think it's really important for us as space activists to reclaim that phrase, because the only true way to have space security is to demilitarize space and not have war in space. So, and what they never show or talk about is what happens in space if you have a missile if you have a mid-course interception. That means in space. And what is it intercepting? A nuclear warhead. So it won't detonate like a bomb, it detonates like a dirty bomb. but it's going to create an incredible debris field and probably a electromagnetic pulse, which will destroy all the space assets, and that means space assets code for satellites. So it's, they never talk about it. I was at this conference and I asked the second commander of STRATCOM, how do you plan to clean up after there's a detonation in a mid-course intercept? And he goes, oh, we don't have any plans, but that's a really good idea. I'm going to bring that back to STRATCOM. And he's such a liar. So that's not talked about, and the connection between missile defense and nuclear weapons is so woven together, but unfortunately the anti-nuclear weapons people don't talk enough about missile defense.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't answer the thing about silver.
So about mining space, who's the gentleman that asked about the silver? They don't ever talk about history because in space there's no people, so who could get hurt? How could there be genocide for mining in space when there's no people out there? I mean, that's the rhetoric, but...
Okay, so now we can take four more questions or comments.
Well, I'm a data normally. I've been in this since 2001. And I want to add or comment in a way. I'm not really sure. I would like to demystify the whole issue. Because I have the feeling as soon as I start to speak in Sweden about all these things, oh yeah, there is a Agneta, she comes with all those. The space. We want to talk about real issues here. I mean, it's sort of a division between the satellites, the militarization of the whole planet. And I would like that we always, when I'm now talking about NATO in Sweden, they are intruding, US is in Sweden since years, doing anything, to sort of combine these two things. Now it is sort of a division between talking about NATO, but don't come with this space issue, Agneta. It is about that. That's what I wanted to comment, that we have to demystify, to, I used to say, well, I would never be able to call my sister's daughter in Durban if the satellite didn't function. We would never be able to talk to each other. Then I take it down to something real. Oh yeah, you're right. I can use my mobile telephone and call my sister's daughter in Durban in South Africa. How come? Yes, and this is done by the minister as well. So I would like to add this, demystifying the whole issue. Thank you.
Thank you for that comment. Is there more questions and comments?
I'd like to know if there are countries around the world that are speaking out against this, and if there are, who are they and how do they do that? What venue do they use, the United Nations or wherever? Is there any real vocalization from a country that's not in the mixed up in the process? I mean, that they know they have something to lose, or maybe they aren't going to get what they should be gaining? Can you speak to that?
English. My name is Song Hye Kim, and South Korea, Songju. SAD가 그렇게 안 좋은 전쟁 무기이고, 또 우리 그 현지에 사는 사람들이 지금 270일째 생업을 다 놓고 반대를 하는데도 불구하고, 미국 정부에서는 왜 이렇게 빨리 졸속하게 그거를 갖다 놓으려고 하는지 전 너무 이해도 안 되고 억울하고 분하고, 그런데 그걸 여기서 학적으로만 이렇게 반대한다거나 하는 것보다는 실제적으로 누군가가 그 책임자를 만난다든지 그거를 배치하려면 국방부라든지 거기에 가서 저지를 해야 되는 거 아닌가 하는 생각이 들어집니다. 그리고 여러분들은 굉장히 존경스럽고요. Thank you.
So I am from Songju, Korea. The SAD is really bad and it's a weapon of the war. And the currently at the people, residents in Songju have been fighting every single day for 270 days. So, but the US government has been expediting in a political vacuum. And I don't really understand what benefit does it bring to the US, and really gets me upset and angry. And you know, it may be important to do these oppositions in a theoretical level and trying to understand the issue, but shouldn't we be also actually be meeting with somebody who's making the decision up in the higher level and tell the truth about what the impact and implications are? I really respect all of your activities, and this is really impressive to me. Thank you very much.
So you said there aren't any people on the asteroids to worry about. Is anybody worrying about life forms before mining?
Okay. All right, well, you want me to start with that one? There is, in NASA, there's planetary protection, and that is that humans don't contaminate when they go to another celestial body, and that they don't reverse contaminate, bring it back. So that's all science fiction stuff where they bring back the stuff and it turns into an alien and kills everybody. But no, they're not concerned about life on the asteroids, because they would be microbial. Maybe there's no atmosphere, there could be water, but you never hear about any concern. Although NASA could piggyback and do some research on to see if there's any microbial life on the asteroids, but that's about it. I don't think they really talk about it. And then I don't remember the other ones you go.
Sabrata, do you want to comment on any of the questions?
Briefly respond to the motivation for the expedited deployment of a FAD. I think that from the Missile Defense Agency's point of view, they want to create FADs on the ground by deploying as many systems. Of course, Raytheon makes a lot of money from this. Each FAD system is about $2 billion. And Donald Trump won South Korean's group foot most of the bill. So that's one thing. And the other thing is, when they say that is operational, the primary motivation there is to basically turn on the radar. And once the THAAD radar, this so-called X-band, very high frequency radar with which can see very small objects, turn on to see potentially any Chinese activity in the missile program, whether China is testing some decoys, launches of missiles, that now they can interface with the FAD. It has nothing to do with North Korea. It's everything to do with China.
Thank you. I would strongly agree with his comments. I think he's right on. It has everything to do with China. I want to tell you a story about North Korea. Some years ago, North Korea did a launch, tested a missile, which is not illegal. It's not illegal under international law to test a missile. We do it all the time. Our allies do it all the time. So in a way, it's totally unfair that North Korea is held to a different standard. They're not allowed to test missiles. But anyway, they tested a missile. And I read a report in one of the space industry publications interviewing some American soldiers who were laughing at North Korea. They were saying, they don't have the space technology capability to track their missile after they launch it from start to finish the way we do. They don't have the ground stations around the world. They don't have the satellites the way we do. And so they can't really follow their own missile. And so these American soldiers were making fun of North Korea. You know, they're like a third-rate junior partner here. That's basically what they were saying. But I think it really underscores the fact that this isn't about North Korea. North Korea has very elementary technology, not a threat to the US, not a threat to Japan, not a threat to South Korea. It's really about putting into place the technology to encircle both Russia and China, to see everything they're doing, and to be able to deliver US first strike attack against Russia and China. That's what this whole thing is about. So in the case of Russia, these deployments now in Romania and Poland, the United States is still saying it's Iran. Oh, it's not Russia. We're putting these missile defense systems to knock out Iranian missiles. But Iran doesn't have any intercontinental ballistic missiles. And Iran has suspended their nuclear missile program. So it's not about Iran. But the United States continues to use this as an excuse.
Oh, one thing I heard at the CSIS conference in relation to this was, I think another thing is that the more missile defense systems are put up on the planet, the easier it is they're going to be able to move them to space. So you put the missile defense in North Korea and Romania and Poland and spread it all out and then say to people, well, wouldn't you just rather have it in space where it's not, you know, causing conflict on Earth? It'd be a lot cleaner. So they're looking at lasers in space, they're looking at rods from God. It's not even China and Russia. It's the global domination of the planet from space, and that's the long-term goal, as it always has been from the 2020 vision.
And just picking up from that point, years ago there was a congressional study published called The Next 50 Years, Space War, The Next 50 Years. And in this U.S. congressional study, they talked about essentially creating a military highway between the Earth and the planetary bodies so that when the day came that they could go out and mine the sky, as Linda's been talking about, the U.S. would control the pathway on and off the Earth to these planetary bodies so that we would be able to determine who could go out and mine and who could not. And in this congressional study, they talked about being able to hijack rival shipments from one place to the other once we put in place this kind of space technology. So she's right. A lot of the things that are being developed today are really just putting the technology in place that will allow them in the next 50 to 100 years, in their mind, go out and control the pathway on and off the planet Earth.
The ultimate high ground is the moon, and that's why the U.S. won't sign on to the moon treaty, because it doesn't allow for military bases on the moon. And I just, you know, I think about this psychosis, right? When there's really no threat from North Korea, there's really no threat from Iran, and are there really threats from Russia? Do we really need to have a moon base to protect our assets? What is the psychosis of these military industrial provocateurs, businessmen and women? And I really think, you know, when we think about Lindis, and I think about this a lot, like, what's wrong with these people? It's a cancer, it's an addiction. And if you ever smoked, I used to smoke cigarettes, you create reasons to go out and have a cigarette. You create, if you're an addict, you create reasons to drink. You create reasons to have your addiction, to get your fix. And there, it being at that conference, the CSIS, in the belly of the beast with all lusting after talking about the weapons, it's a deep psychosis. And, you know, I'm not a psychiatrist, but it's a deep sickness of the soul. I say, my son is 12. He says, Mom, how can people do stuff like this? I say, they have a cancer of the soul. I don't. That's all I can say. So we have to address that. And I'll pass it back to Bruce on that.
Oh, we're almost out of time. Sabrata, you want to make any closing statement real quick?
No, I think there's a quick one on the South Korean situation, because I've been trying to follow it. I was in Seoul a couple of months ago before my situation with I happened, and I was sitting in the foreign ministry with a Japanese professor who I was there with, and it was incredible that this whole South Korean foreign ministry people that were there, they were much more gung-ho than even the people who came from the United States at that meeting about taking this very tough line on North Korea and about the THAAD and things like that. So I think that there is a real issue now with the elections coming up, the Pentagon and the and Washington in general are very concerned that there could be a change in government which could take a different view of the THAAD deployment. So they want to get this done. And I would urge our South Korean colleague and from Seoul and that they need to take a real close look at this, the bureaucrats in the foreign ministry who control this policy and do a real house cleaning after the election if the opportunity arises.
Thanks, Sabrata. Thanks for coming on with us today, too.
We all need to do better. Uh-oh, and it's still over.
Hey, what about the question, are any other country, any countries helping?
I wanted to answer the other question about other countries, yes. Every year when the prevention of an arms race in outer space legislation or treaty is introduced at the UN. Historically, it comes from Russia and China. They introduce it. But for many years, Canada was a partner in introducing that. But I think in recent years, the United States has neutralized Canada because Canadian corporations, aerospace corporations, are now increasingly being brought into this program. So anytime the United States wants to neutralize any particular critic country, what they're doing is going and getting their aerospace industry involved, and that's had an effect of neutralizing those particular countries. So outside of that, there isn't really any countries that are major critics today of what the United States is planning in space. Russia and China are the two big ones. And they've been saying for the last at least 5 years that with missile defense, that it's putting them in a position that they can no longer have any negotiations for nuclear disarmament. They can't afford to reduce their nuclear retaliatory capability because of U.S. missile defense deployments. So any hope for nuclear disarmament is smashed by missile defense. And the United States knows that and is quite happy with that condition. So.
So I think we're about out of time. Thank you.